everybody and welcome back to Food Tech Learning. Today we will start with the Millard reaction. In my first video, I have made a lecture on Browning reaction, that is part one on enzymatic Browning reaction, and the second one is on non-enzymatic Browning reaction, and that too particularly about the caramelization. In this my third lecture, I will particularly deal about the Millard reaction. Now, you might be thinking that how did it get its name, the Millard reaction? Actually, the Millard reaction has gotten its name through its inventor, who was Louis Camille Millard. Actually, in 1930, he published his dissertation on this reaction. So, it get its name through its inventor, who was Louis Camille Millard. So, okay, now let us learn about the definition of this Millard reaction. So, it is a non-oxidative and non-enzymatic process in which the carbonyl group of reducing sugar readily combines with the amino group of protein, peptides, amino acids, resulting in the sugar amine. Then the sugar amine, it undergoes set of various reactions resulting in the Browning, is known as the Millard reaction. Actually, this Millard reaction is a very complex process and a very complex reactions go through it, So, let me first read this definition and I will make you understand this very clearly, step by step. So, here the process undergoes condensation, enolization, amidori rearrangement, polymerization, deamination, forming the red-brown compounds, then the brown to black amorphous unsaturated heterogeneous polymers are called as the melanoids. And now the question is, and Millard reaction basically requires two ingredients. It is totally different from the caramelization. There we have learned that caramelization, only the ingredient needed is sugar, the carbohydrate. But here, for the Millard reaction to occur, there are two main ingredients which should be present for the initiation of the Millard reaction, and that two are, first of all is the reducing sugar, and the second is the proteins. So proteins are what? Proteins are basically the building blocks of amino acids. Now the question arises that where do you see all this Millard reaction? See, you can observe this Millard reaction in the meat, red meat, milk, coffee, and there are many more items, like even the bread. If you take a bun and if you put a butter as and if you just toast it, you will observe that it changes to the brown color, a reddish brown color. That is due to the Millard reaction, because in bun and butter, when you apply butter on bun, actually what happens, see, bun is of what? Carbohydrates. And the butter, what does it contains? Butter contains a protein. So there is the reaction between the sugar as well as the amino acid from the protein, and it forms, and it undergoes a certain reactions, and it basically forms a brown color there. So you can observe in all these items, food items. So let me make this very clear, this Millard reaction, how this happens, what are the chemical reaction occurring in this. So I will deal all this step by step. See, in red meat, you will observe that when you roast this meat, it changes its color from the red to the brownish stripe. Even in milk also, you will observe that when you just apply heat to the milk, if the time duration is more, what will you observe is that the milk changes its color. And the second is the coffee also. Actually, what the original, if the raw coffee beans, if you see, they are basically, they are green in color and they are very bitter in taste. So what happened is that these are basically roasted, because you know coffee beans, actually it contains sugar also, as well as it contain protein. So when it is roasted, when heat is applied to it, there occurs the Millard reaction, and hence the flavor and the taste of the coffee beans and even the color changes just because of the Millard reaction in milk also and in red meat also. So let me make, and you know, in milk, basically In milk also, what is present in milk, there is a lactose in the form of sugar, as well as the lysine, the amino acid, there a lysine is present. So this amino acids reacts with the lactose sugar, and hence it forms a, and as lactose is a reducing sugar, so basically they undergoes the Maillard reaction. And same goes to the red meat, meat also, because meat also contains a protein as well as a carbohydrate. So there occurs the Maillard reaction. So let me deal with the steps. Okay, so let us see how this Maillard reaction occurs. See, for the initiation of Maillard reaction, the temperature basically cited is 230 to 340 degree Fahrenheit. You can take it as 110 to 170 degree in Celsius. Now, there are basically four steps involved in this Maillard reaction. So let us learn the whole step, all the four steps one by one. In the first step, what happens that the carbonyl group of the sugar, it reacts with the amino group of the amino acid to produce the N-substituted glycosamine and the H2O. See what happened. The carbonyl group, what's the carbonyl group? This is the carbonyl group of the, basically of the reducing, the sugar taken here is of reducing type. So what does the reducing mean? See, I'm just drawing here. See, just draw the structure of the glucose. Suppose I'm taking alpha glucose, CH2OH, and this is this. See, for the, if like you have to see that the glucose is of reducing type or not, what you have to see is for the aldose sugar. See, aldose means what? We have taken the aldehyde. See, there is aldehyde, CHO, aldehyde is here. So for the aldose sugar, we have to see the hemiacetal form. We have to see hemiacetal, and in that what we have to see, we have to see the OH, ether and H. Presence of this will signifies that it is a hemiacetal. And for the keto sugar, what we have to see? We have to see the hemiketal. And for hemiketal, what should be the presence? OH, ether and R group. See, how we will know that this is a reducing sugar? See, here this carbon has OH also, it has, as well as to this carbon, ether group is also attached. This is an ether group, ROR is ether. So this is an ether group is also attached, and H is also attached. So this is a reducing sugar. Okay, and same occurs if you take the fructose. So same with the fructose. In fructose, there will be CH2OH. The R will be here, ether will be here, and OH will be here. So this is all about how to identify which is a reducing sugar. So this is a reducing sugar, glucose. And we have taken the amino group of the amino acid. And we have taken the amino groups. This is, you know, this amino group is basically a nucleophile. Nucleophile means they are nucleus lover. Or we can say they are electron rich species. So this is a nucleophile. Now this carbonyl group here is basically a polar functional group. Polar functional group, what does this mean? This means that due to the oxygen has a more electronegative element. So what does it will do? It will attract the electron towards itself, and it will create a partial charge. Partial negative on this oxygen and partial positive on the carbon. So there is an as it has developed a partial positive and negative charge. Now what will happen? See, the negative attracts to the positive, and the positive will attract to the negative. So this nucleophile will be attracted, or this is an attacking reagent. Basically, this is an attacking reagent. This nucleophile, and this nucleophile will attack where? It will attack on the plus. You know, this partial positive. That means carbon. It will attack to the carbon, and here as it attack to the carbon, what will it do? It will form this structure. So it will form what? It will form a glycosyl amine. H2 from here will attack, this proton will attack the electron rich, that is the negative part. So here there will be OH2, and we all know that OH2 is a very good leaving group. So it will leave from here, it will release in the form of water, and as this releases out, there will be the double bond created here, and so this glycosamine, we also call as sieve base. You might be finding somewhere in the book that it's written the sieve base, so we also call it as a sieve base. Okay, so this is all about this part, how the glycosyl amine is formed. Okay, so let us move to the next step. What happened after the formation of the glycosamine? What happened that the glycosamine undergoes the amidory rearrangement to form the ketose amine. Now you might be thinking that what is the amidory rearrangement? See, amidory arrangement is what? Basically, it is the process in which the glycosamine is being converted to the ketose sugar. That is 1-amino-2 ketose sugar. So this is only the amidory rearrangement, whereas the rearrangement occurs between the So what happened that these glycosamine, what happened? See, again, if you see in this step, this N double bond C is there. Again, N is more electronegative. It will attract the this electron. See, this is a pi electron present here, and this pi is basically the it is a localized one. So it is a delocalized. So what will happen? So what will happen? This electron will shift here and it will form a lone pair here. If lone pair is formed, what will happen? It requires a proton. The H from here, basically it releases out from it, removes moves here in the form of H plus, and it attacks here the lone pair, and it forms a bond here, and this electron which is here, it moves here and it forms a double bond here. So this is about what you, this is 1-2 in aminol is formed here. Now what is after this, after the formation of 1-2 in aminol, what happens? There is a tautomerism, you can say ketoenol tautomerism, or you can also tell it as an enolization. It's basically the 1-3 hydrogen shift. What is it? It is 1-3 hydrogen shift. So the hydrogen, there is shift from 1 and 3. It is called as 1-3 hydrogen shift. So let me make you more clear how this happened. See, just name it. If we name it 1, 2 and 3, what you notice here in this enol form is that this bond shifted here, and this H from here is attacking here. So you can see the H is removed from here and it attacks here, and this bond shifted from here. So it is basically 1-3 hydrogen shift. Only there is the play of the hydrogen here, only the hydrogen shift along with the double bond. So this is all about enolization. Now, one thing I wanted to tell you that here, this enol, 1-2 in aminol, is basically an intermediate, and this intermediate is unstable. You know, this is unstable. Now the reason behind is why it is unstable and why this enol form changes to the ketose form. Because what you see here, C double bond C. C double bond C, and in ketose what you see? C double bond O. Which bond is more stronger? C double bond O is more stronger, so it is more stable form, and this is less stable. That's the reason the keto form, you will find keto form in more abundance rather than this. This is found in very less percentage in all form. So this keto is more stable, and hence we get this keto as a product, last product. And this is the amidory product. We also tell it as an amidory product. And this is 1-amino-2 keto. 1-amino means why? Carbon 1, we have an amino group, and carbon 2, we have a keto group. So it is 1-amino-2 keto sugar is formed here. And this is also called as the amidory product. Now let's proceed to our third step. What's the third step? What happens after the formation of the amidory product? Okay, so in the third step, what happens is that this was the amidory product, 2-keto sugar. So this was amidory product. What will happen? This amidory product will further undergo deamination, means this amine group will be removed, and it will form a 3-deoxyhexo xylose, and in this oxygen is also being removed. It further it undergo condensation here also, and even there is removal of oxygen. Sorry, oxygen is also removed. So it basically it forms the 3-deoxyhexoxylose. This is what. At third position, you can see there is no oxygen. After that, it undergoes the condensation reaction, and it basically it forms a hexo sugar. This is hexo sugar. This hexo sugar further undergo condensation, and it will produce what? It will produce a furan. That is 5-hydroxymethyl-2-furaldehyde. So this furaldehyde is basically responsible for the flavor. You know, the flavor which we see, the flavor which we taste in the I have told you about the coffee beans and the roasted form of coffee beans or the meat. This is all about this HMF is responsible there. So this is one product formed during the Maillard reaction. So there are variety of products formed during the Maillard reaction, and these products finally they combine to form a polymer that is melanoidine. So what happened in the fourth step is that once this molecule with the two double bonded oxygen atom have been formed, this means what? That when the dicarbonyl is basically formed, what happens? They can participate in the Stryker's reaction. Stryker degradation you might have heard about. See, what is Stryker reaction is that it involves the alpha dicarbonyl compound and as well as the alpha amino compound. Here there is 2,3 butane-dione, you know, because a alkane group is present and dione because 2 dicarbonyl group is present and in the position of 2 and 3. So it is 2,3 butane-dione, and this is L-valine, that is the amino group. So basically the dicarbonyl group, it reacts with the amino acid here and it undergoes decarboxylation, means removal of carbon dioxide, and it forms 3-amino-2-butanone, and with that it also forms the methyl propanol. Okay, so what happens, this 3-amino-2-butanone basically it again reacts with the 3-amino-2-butanone and it's form a ring here, and that is what, and basically it forms what, it forms the tetramethylpyrazine, and this tetramethylpyrazine is basically responsible for the, basically this pyrazine, this is responsible for the aroma and the flavor. So let us what happens after that? After these all products are formed, these products basically they form a chain. You know, they form a polymer and they undergo polymerization and they form the melanoidin that is basically responsible for the brown coloration, that is responsible for the color. These products are responsible for the aroma and the flavor, and the melanoidin is responsible for the color, that is the brown color, the brown-black color which we see in a food item. A question might be arising in your mind that does this Maillard reaction reduces the nutritional value of the food? Yes, then you are absolutely correct. Yes, it reduces the nutritional food because the amino acid, basically a protein is a building block of amino acid, and when this amino acids, when they combine with the sugar or the carbohydrates, what happen? They loses their identity. This amino acid, they loses their identity and they are just converted to the other products which are basically responsible for the flavor and aroma. So hence the nutritional value of the food, like the if you boil the milk, its nutritional value basically reduces because you know this milk contains a lactose sugar. So lactose in the form of sugar is there, and even it and as we all know that it is a complete food, so it contains a protein also, and in protein also basically what which amino acid is present, there is an absolute lysine is present there, and that lysine basically take part in this Maillard reaction, and hence the its nutritional as it take part in the Maillard reaction and it loses its identity, and hence it loses its nutritional value. And same goes with the coffee beans, as I have told you earlier, and same with the red meat also. When the meat changes its color from red to the brown, it also loses its identity, the protein. So yes, the Maillard reaction, when but not to the greater extent, but to the some extent, it depends upon the amount of heat you basically give it. Okay, so let us summarize this Maillard reaction. This reactions what happened? This is the glucose. This glucose, when the nucleophile attacks here, this glucose, it forms a glycosyl amine. You know, when this attacks on the carbonyl, it forms a glycosamine. After this, there is against what happened, this nitrogen at is electronegative, it attracts this electron towards itself and it forms this. This is 1,2-N aminol. After this 1,2-N aminol, there occurs the enolization. Enolization means 1,3 hydrogen shift. There is shift of the hydrogen as well as the double bond. So this is the amidori product we get here. That is 1-amino-2-keto-sugar. After that, it undergoes a deamination and it forms this 3-deoxyhexulose. After that, it again undergoes the condensation and it forms again. This is the keto. This is also again a hexo sugar. This also undergoes the condensation and it forms a furan. That is a 5-hydroxy-2-methylfuraldehyde. It forms. So this is one of the product which is formed in the Maillard reaction. See, after this amidori product, there are various steps. You know, various methods or various reactions occurs. This is one which I have shown you. This amidori product, this is one which I have shown you, the formation of 5-hydroxymethylfuron. There are a lot of like reductants are formed, methyl propanol. There are a lot more are formed. This is only the one process which I have shown. In this process, there is a formation of the dicarbonyl compound. So what happened? This dicarbonyl compound, like here, 2,3. So this is butane dione. It then reacts with the valine, your L valine, and this undergo decarboxylation. So this form a 3-amino-2-butone, and this again reacts with the 3-amino-2-butone, and it forms the tetramethylpyrazine here. This tetramethylpyrazine, they forms a polymer and they forms a melanodyne at lastly, which is responsible for the color, and these products are responsible for the flavor and the aroma, the pyrazine as well as the HMF. So now the question might, if you just fry a onion with the baking soda, it will enhance the color. The color of the onion, it changes to brown very fast because it enhances the Maillard reaction. The alkaline solution, it basically enhances the Maillard reaction. So you might be thinking, so is there any way to inhibit or reduce this Maillard reaction? Yes, there is absolutely a way to inhibit it. What you can do, what can be done, what is done basically is, like, if we reduces the, okay, let me write one by one, how can we inhibit it? By lowering the pH. If we lower the pH to the less acidic, so it Maillard reaction will be inhibited. Number two, by lowering the temperature. If we lower the temperature, it also inhibits the Maillard reaction. Somewhere reduces the Maillard reaction basically. Third is, you know, by using the non-reducing sugar, because the sugar used here is reducing sugar. So if you add a sucrose here, sucrose is basically a non-reducing sugar. So the Maillard reaction here will not take place. So by using a non-reducing sugar, you can add a non-reducing to just inhibit this Maillard reaction. Fourth is, you can also add, like, for the storage purpose of the dehydrated foods, basically the sulfur dioxide as well as sulfite and sulfur dioxides are basically used, that is for the dehydrated food to store. And this basically, what does it do? This inhibits the browning in that. This inhibits the browning of the stored food item, and hence it inhibits the Maillard reaction. So these are some of the ways you can just reduce the Maillard reaction. And one more, you can also reduce the Maillard reaction by a aminobutadiene. That is a pharmaceutical drug. Basically, it trap a dicarbonyl and it just inhibit the Maillard reaction. And we can also see the trapping agents are many. Like, you can also use the hydroxytyrosol, then creatine, and then pyridoxamine can also inhibit this reaction. So this is all about the Maillard reaction. If you have any doubt, you can just comment below. Thank you.